Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship on this third Sunday of Advent. We have had the Sunday of hope and the Sunday of peace, and today is the Sunday of joy. And I can tell you, I'm feeling joyful because I'm starting to feel well from, you know, after the COVID when I was kind of exhausted, and also no cane today. So coming along, I hope all goes well with the stairs and everything, but I'm excited. I feel great. So all sorts of announcements today, but the first thing I want to do is our secret angel drawing. So what we've been doing is I have the names of our members who are in care homes or assisted living facilities, and also some people here at the Blue Hill home who don't have family and don't receive much mail. So these people right now, this has been an extremely difficult time, almost a year going on now, where they've been isolated and haven't been able to hug their loved ones or have visitors. So I thought it would be fun to draw a name every week and send a card or a note to whosoever name you draw. This is optional, of course. I don't have enough names for everybody who's here today, which is great, but if you don't get a chance this week, maybe next week. So anyway, if you would be willing this week to send a note or a card to someone who's in a care facility, here is the basket. I'm going to start in the back because I started in the front last week. Okay, anybody else? All right. Okay. You got two. Well, we can't have that. Okay, anybody? Yeah. Okay. Did you get, yeah, you can trade. All right, here's another one. Okay. Got one more. Anybody else want to do one this time? Oh, good. All right. You want to give that to Callan and Paisley? Awesome, guys. Thank you. All right. Now I have to fix the microphone. There we go. So between the mask, the glasses, the microphone, I'm glad I don't have a hearing aid, too. That's a lot going on behind the ear. So, okay. All right. Well, as far as other announcements, I wanted to remind you that if you want to contribute a poinsettia in honor of someone or in memory of someone for our Christmas services, there's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board. They're $18, and Steph will provide those and do all the work. All you have to do is sign up. Also, caroling that's happening at the Blue Hill Care Center, sponsored by the Bladen Girl Scouts, I learned, is not at 5 o'clock, as I said last week, but 3 o'clock on Friday. So 3 o'clock on Friday, anyone who wants to join in, and they're going to go from window to window and try to carol for all the residents. We're adding several things to our prayer list. We will be adding Marissa Lurie's mother, Peggy, who was in the hospital with COVID, and while there, they discovered that she's got cancer pretty much throughout her body. So that's of great concern. So we'll be adding Peggy to our prayer list. And I've been asked to add Mandy Akengay, who has COVID, and so we'll be adding her. And then we will be remembering the family of Wilma Scholes. She passed away this week peacefully at Red Cloud at the care center there. And I had talked to her 2 or 3 days before that, and she was still able to be on the phone with me, and I could pray with her, but she has slipped away at the age of 99, so they will be only having a graveside service for her now, and then hopefully in the spring, when we're past the COVID restrictions, they will have an actual memorial service here at the church that everyone will be able to come to at that time. And we will have Luella Willem's service this week here at the church, but it is a private service. But please be praying for both those families. Does anybody else have anything this morning that we need to announce? Or any other prayer concerns? It's Friday at 3. Today at 3. Well, then I don't know. I'm wrong, I think. I have a feeling you would know. So I may have been told wrong about the caroling. It may be today at 3. So it sounds like, I think being part of the Girl Scouts, Trish would know. Okay, Missy said that. So let's just say caroling today at 3. And if you go there and you don't want to do a solo, then I guess come back on Friday. But I bet it's today. I was told wrong, so thank you. Okay. All right. Anything else this morning? All right. The peace of Christ be with you always. The days are coming, says the Lord, when God's promises to Israel and Judah will be fulfilled. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our gathering song is found in the red hymnal. It is number 240. I can't read the number. 242. Awake, awake, and greet the new morn. At this time, we will have the lighting of our Advent wreath. We begin by singing, "Light Three Candles to Watch for Messiah." On the first Sunday of Advent, we lit the candle of hope, reminding us of the hope we have in Christ Jesus. On the second Sunday, we lit the candle of peace, which reminds us that Jesus is the Prince of Peace and gives us true peace in our hearts, no matter what's going on in the world. Today, we will light the candle of joy, the pink candle, because today is the day that we remember the joy we have in knowing that Jesus is our Savior and that He came to save us. As we look at the light of this candle, we celebrate the joy we have in Jesus Christ. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, thank You for not leaving us in darkness, but for sending Your light into the world instead. Help us to shine Your light in the dark and dreary corners of the world. May the joy of knowing Your light and love radiate from us to everyone we meet. Thank You for making us Yours as we wait for You to come again. Amen. Please be seated. Our praise hymn is "How Great is Our God," and it's up on the screen.
Age to age, is our God. Sing with me, Havaray is our God, and all will see Havaray. How great is our
Psalm 126 is a prayer for spiritual revival and reawakening. The first half is all happiness and joy, remembering how God answered this prayer once. But now that's just a memory, like a dream. The people need to be renewed again, so they call out to God once more. Transform, restore, deliver us again. Don't you think this is a prayer that God's people need to pray today? God invites us to prayer. He's even putting the very words in our mouths. Please read responsively with me Psalm 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy. The author of this reading is the Apostle Paul, who suffered illness, imprisonment, ridicule, shipwreck, beatings, and eventually death for the sake of sharing the good news of Jesus. But here he reminds us that having Jesus in our hearts and lives allows us to rejoice, that is, to be filled to the brim with inner joy, no matter what our circumstances might be. Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 24. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. Thank you.
right. Kids, both old and young. My children's message is always for everybody, you know, and the ones watching at home, too. Hi to you guys. So we are going to hear a story in a little bit about a man named John the Baptist. Okay, so here is a picture of what he might have looked like. We don't really know for sure what he looked like, but this might be kind of what he looked like because he lived out in the desert, and he didn't really get to go have his hair cut or have a razor to shave his beard, and he lived by eating wild honey and locusts. Do you know what locusts are? They're grasshoppers. So he ate grasshoppers. So he lived kind of a crazy life, and because he was kind of wild and crazy and different, tons of people wanted to see him and hear him, and they came out into the desert to talk to John and to hear him. So what do I have here? Do you know what this is, anybody? Do you know what it is? Maybe this will help. If I know what that is, I don't want to blind anybody, but flashlight, right? Yeah. So, we're also going to hear about light today when I read the story. So, what do you do with a flashlight? Why do we use a flashlight? Yeah, we use it to see things, right? So, if I'm outside at night and I need to walk somewhere, I can use the flashlight and shine it down where my feet are and I can see where I'm going. Or, if I'm working on something and I'm trying to fix something, I can set the flashlight down and shine it up under, this wouldn't be me, this would be Rick, but shine it up under the car or the truck or whatever I'm working on so I can see what I'm doing, right? And this is a pretty fancy flashlight because I can also do a blinking light like this. So if I'm out on the highway and my tire's flat and I need help or something, I can have a shiny blinking light. I just don't want to shine it in anybody's face. Okay? So, what would happen if I wanted to draw attention to somebody? I could use it like a spotlight too, right? But if I want to see what I'm doing, what I'm working on, where I'm walking, does it do me any good if I shine it like this? Does this help me know where I'm walking? No. This wouldn't help me fix my car, right, if I shine it on me? Well, that's what John said too. Because people would come out to see him and hear him, and he's like, no, 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 I'm not the light. Don't pay attention to me. I'm pointing at the light. I'm shining the light. So he was wanting to shine the light to who? Who do you think John wanted to tell everybody about? Jesus. That's right. So when John was out in the desert, his whole job was to tell everybody about Jesus. And that's what he did, and that's what the light was all about. Not about John, but about Jesus. And that's what he wants us to do, too. He doesn't want us to shine lights on ourselves and make everything about us and what we do and who we are. He wants us to point our lights to Jesus and let everyone see Jesus in us. Okay? Let's pray about that. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for sending John the Baptist and Isaiah and all the prophets who pointed the light to Jesus. And most of all, we thank you for Jesus who came to be the light of the world because he loved us so much. Help us to shine our lights on him so that everyone can see his love when they look at us. Amen. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. John the Baptist was the last of the prophets, the one who came to prepare the people for the coming of Jesus, the light of the world. Today's gospel reading is from John, the first chapter. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. This is the testimony given by John when the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" He confessed and did not deny it, but confessed, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Then they said to him, "Who are you? Let us have an answer for those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Now, they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Why then are you baptizing if you are neither the Messiah nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water. Among you stands one whom you do not know, the one who is coming after me. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." This took place in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptizing. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated. So, an elderly woman was well known in her neighborhood for stepping out on her front porch every morning and saying loudly, "Praise the Lord! It's a beautiful morning." Or even, "Praise the Lord! It's raining today." She found some way to shout out, "Praise the Lord," every single day. This really irritated the old lady's neighbor next door. Every time the woman would shout out, "Praise the Lord," the old man next door would yell, "There ain't no Lord." Finally, the old man decided to play a trick on the old lady. He purchased a large bag of groceries and put them on her porch early one morning and waited for her to shout, "Praise the Lord." That's when he planned to yell, "The Lord didn't give you them groceries, I did." He seemed to wait forever. But finally, the old woman made her way to the porch, opened the door, and saw the groceries. "Praise the Lord," she shouted. "The Lord gave me a bag of groceries, and he got the devil to pay for them." This story reminds me of one of my favorite Bible passages, which is found in our second reading for today. "Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances." The old lady in the story obviously took that verse to heart, right? Although we might get a good laugh out of the joke, the admonition that Paul gives here to the Christians in Thessalonica is pretty serious. And let's face it, it's not always easy to follow. Let's look at the three things that we're told to do in this verse. First, rejoice always. Always is one of those words we like to avoid in situations like this. Rejoice sometimes? We can do that. Rejoice when things are going our way? Sure. Rejoice when we feel good, when we've had enough sleep, when the sun is shining and the birds are singing and life is beautiful? Absolutely. But rejoice always? How can we rejoice when someone has hurt our feelings terribly? How can we rejoice when we're suffering from diabetes or rheumatoid arthritis or cancer? How can we rejoice when a precious loved one has died, or our children are straying far from our teachings, or we're faced with losing our job? How can we rejoice in the middle of a pandemic when so many people we know are ill or have died or are facing economic ruin? How can we rejoice when we're afraid we might be next? Well, there are no quick and simple answers to that question. I feel supremely unqualified to answer because although I've had problems and struggles, I've never really faced the terrible difficulties that some people are dealing with. And I'd venture to guess that no one sitting in this church this morning has ever faced the kind of violence, starvation, or even torture that some people in our world live with every day. But even so, we have struggles and troubles, and sometimes we just feel overwhelmed with it all. All I can say is this: God's word is clear, and God's word is our guide. So if God wants us to rejoice, then we must rejoice. I'm not talking here about the kind of superficial happiness that our consumer-driven culture is so obsessed with. Rejoicing, being filled with joy, is not the same as being happy. It goes much deeper than that. True rejoicing has to do with being filled with God's peace, the peace that passes understanding. This is not something we can obtain for ourselves. It is a gift we are given. When we place ourselves solely in God's care, when we allow our wants, wishes, and desires to take second place to His, when we remember that He is in control and will order all things according to His purposes, then true joy comes flooding in. We can't always hang on to it, or at least I can't. But experiencing that kind of peace and joy is like a little foretaste of heaven, the place where God's will is always done, where everything will be made right and be made new. There's another reason why rejoicing always is a basic command for Christians. Timothy Keller, a Presbyterian pastor, talks about this in his wonderful book, The Reason for God. In the book, Keller describes a terrible nightmare he had where he dreamed his wife and children were all dead. He describes the absolute agony he felt in the dream and then the unbelievable relief and joy he experienced when he woke up and realized it was all just a dream, that his family was alive and well and safe. The dream made him realize how grateful he should be every day to have his family safely with him. Why, he wondered, do we take it all for granted? Why don't we appreciate what we have until we lose it? As Christians, we have had a similar experience. We have been trapped in the nightmare of sin and sorrow and then released from it, rescued from it by the death and resurrection of Jesus. If we think about this at all, if we reflect on the enormity of what Jesus has done for us, we should wake up every day full of profound joy, gratitude, and rejoicing. We're like the criminal who's received a last-minute stay of execution. How can we not rejoice? Paul's second admonition is to pray without ceasing. Pray all the time is how one modern translation puts it. There's another one of those words, all the time. Sounds kind of like rejoice always. Is it really possible to pray all the time? Let's talk about prayer for a bit. Prayer is one of the most important spiritual disciplines. A deep, abiding prayer life is absolutely essential for our growth in the faith. Oswald Chambers puts it like this: prayer is the way the life of God is nourished. We tend to look upon prayer as a way of getting things for ourselves. The Bible's idea of prayer is that we may get to know God Himself. I'm afraid that too often our prayer time is something like a shopping list. We come to God with a list of things that we want and ask Him to grant our desires. Or we don't even do that much. We just wait until some crisis occurs, and then we turn to God for help. Of course, God wants us to come to Him with our problems and our needs, and He especially wants us to pray for other people. But when you begin to pray without ceasing, you find that there's much more to it than that. Prayer is God's way of having a relationship with us. So often, we think of prayer as something we do to break through to God, to get His attention and have Him listen to us. But intimacy with God is His idea. He has taken the initiative, and prayer is His gift to us. God, the all-powerful, all-knowing creator of the universe, wants to be your best friend. He wants to be so much a part of your life that you come to Him at all times, naturally, without even thinking about it. Prayer becomes an ongoing conversation that takes place throughout the day, no matter what you're doing. You begin to go to God first, to thank Him for your blessings, to ask for His advice, to seek forgiveness when you make a mistake. You don't have to wait until your bedtime prayers or church on Sunday. You talk and you listen all the time. And we often then begin to share that relationship with other people. Without even trying, without even thinking about it, you begin to pray for and with other people. Rick and I had a former pastor who was a wonderful example of this kind of prayer. He will pray with anyone, anytime. If he's shaking hands with you after church and you tell him about something you're concerned about, he stops the line right there and takes your hands and prays with you. If somebody seeks his advice over the phone, he'll pray with them right over the phone. Going to God with every joy and concern is so natural to Him that He doesn't even think about it. He just does it. So, we have rejoice always and pray without ceasing. What's the third part of the equation? Give thanks in all circumstances. There's that word all again. Give thanks in all circumstances. Is that easy? Not a bit. Is it possible? Yes, with God's help. This one is about having an attitude of gratitude, which does not come naturally to many of us. It's so much easier to grumble and complain and dwell on the negative. As soon as we wake up every morning, we have a choice. We can either allow ourselves to think about all the problems and worries of the day, or we can thank God for our blessings and turn everything over to Him. It can almost become like a game. Nearly anything negative we think of can be turned around into something to thank God for. If I'm not feeling well, I can still thank God that I'm lying in a comfortable bed and that I live in a place where I have access to good medical care. If I'm having problems at work, I can be thankful that I have a job and a way to support my family. If my clothes are fitting a little too tight, I can be thankful that at least I have plenty to eat. If the kids have left the house in a mess, I can be thankful that they're safe and healthy and living with me. Have you ever noticed that after you've been sick, you appreciate feeling well in a whole new way? Since having COVID-19 and feeling so weak I could barely walk across a room, I feel fortunate to have the energy to be here today with you this morning, and I appreciate the joy of worshiping with you in a whole new way. Somebody else I know who had COVID and then got over it got up one morning and said, "I feel like I've been resurrected." You know, it's just, you appreciate the simple joys of life in a whole new way. But this experience with the virus has also made me wonder about something else that I have wondered about before. Why me? Why were Rick and I so fortunate as to have fairly mild cases of COVID compared to some people who are struggling for breath or dying alone in a hospital room? Why were my children born healthy while some people's babies are fighting cancer or facing multiple surgeries? Why am I free to preach and worship God openly while some people are imprisoned or killed for doing the same? Why am I so blessed? Well, as I've told you before, the why questions are the ones we can't really answer. Pastors can't answer them. Professors and theologians can't answer them. Only God can answer them, and He has not chosen to reveal some of those answers to us now. Why some are so blessed and others seem to suffer more than their share is something we have to leave in God's hands. Our blessings are not something we earn or deserve. They are, like all God's gifts to us, pure grace. You may not ever know why you were chosen to be blessed. And you may not understand why God loved you so much that He was willing to enter into this broken world to suffer and to die for you. But you can absolutely believe it. God has given me this word for you today. He loves you, and He forgives you, and He has chosen you to be His. His birth as a helpless baby in a manger, His suffering and pain in life, His agonizing death on a cross, and the miracle of His resurrection, all of these were for you. You don't need to wonder. You don't need to ask, why me? You can simply rejoice. Amen. Our song is In Christ Alone, and you'll find it up on the screen.
In Christ alone.
At this time, I would invite you to stand as you are able and to join in our response to the word of what God has done for us by confessing the things we have done wrong and asking for his forgiveness, which he gladly gives. The Lord proclaimed, "Behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. Let us take this time to examine ourselves, asking for forgiveness for the things which we have done that are not pleasing to the Lord and the things which we have neglected." God of grace, we confess that we have not been attentive to the urgent call to prepare for the coming of your Son. Prepare our hearts to follow Jesus in doing your holy will. Forgive us, we pray, and shape our lives according to the cross of Christ, who has called us to walk in his ways. Restore us to a right relationship with you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the name of Jesus, God's only Son, who came to do the will of his Father, you are forgiven. By Christ's holy sacrifice, your sins are wiped clean and you are made right with our Heavenly Father. Rejoice in this free gift and take it to heart. I invite you to join in the creed, which will be up on the screen. You may be seated.
Our Father everlasting, the
At this time, I invite you to stand as you are able as we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your heavenly gift of joy. We thank you that our joy does not need to depend on the circumstances we're in the things that happen to us, but only on the knowledge that you loved us, that you save us, and that you are with us throughout everything. We ask that you would give us that spirit of joy and thanksgiving as we go out into the world so that it shines from us to everyone we meet. Heavenly Father, the Christmas season is often a time when people feel pressured to be superficially happy and jolly and feel immense pressure for things to be perfect and for the family to get along and the decorations to be beautiful and the food to be delicious. And all of those things we know are not what Christmas is truly about. We pray that you would still our hearts and our busyness and our pressure and our disappointment, that you would bring all that before you and take it from us, Lord, so that we focus on the true beauty of the season, which is knowing that you were born into this world to be with us and to save us. We pray for those who are sad and grieving at this time. We lift up those who have lost loved ones. There have been so many, Lord, lately. And we pray especially for the families of Luella Willems and Wilma Scholes and all others whom we name before you in our hearts. Father, we pray during this time of pandemic that you would be at work in these circumstances in the world. We pray for all those who are suffering, those who are at home, those who are in the hospital, those who are isolated, and those throughout the world who don't even have medical care. Lord, be present. Be present and let this time come to an end. We lift up healthcare workers who are overwhelmed and burdened right now. We pray that you would give them everything they need, that they would have help where needed, that there would be enough workers, there would be enough beds, that there would be enough supplies, that everything would be done according to your will. Sustain them in this time, Lord, and help them to know that you are with them every step of the way. Father, we pray for the church here in Blue Hill and throughout the world. We pray for your body as it does your work in the world, and we pray especially for the places where Christians are persecuted for bearing the name of Jesus. Let us never forget, and let us never forget to be grateful for the freedoms we enjoy. Father, we ask you in the coming 2 weeks that are left of Advent that you would prepare our hearts to receive you, both as a baby in a manger, as our victorious Lord and Savior, and as the one who will come again to bring perfect and eternal peace, hope, and joy to the world when you come back to make all things new. We thank you, Lord, that we have this promise that we can cling to no matter what happens. Father, we lift up those who are suffering from any kind of illness or distress or loneliness or isolation. We pray for our homebound loved ones. We especially lift up Amy Sue, Mike, Scott, Artis, Bob, Darlene, Tana, Chuck, Tom, Colleen, Roland, Kyson, Bonna, Peggy, Mandy, and all others whom we name before you in our hearts. Into your hands, Heavenly Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your great mercy and knowing that you are in control and in charge of all things and that all will be done according to your will. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior, Messiah, and King. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As you go from this place, remember that with God, nothing is impossible. May the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go before you, beside you, and with you wherever you go. Amen. Go in peace, prepare the way of the Lord. You may be seated for our sending song, which is Joy to the World, number 267 in the red hymnal.